So, Talking Sopranos, episode 10 today, and I am excited, my friend.
Yeah, very special guests. We have two women who a lot of maybe our audience and fans might not recognize their faces or their names, probably their names, but very, very, very critical to the success of this show, as critical absolutely. As anybody. And, you know, we're really, really proud and excited to have them on today. Sheila Jaffe and Georgianne Walken, who were the casting directors of The Sopranos.
They've cast over 150 movies and TV shows, still doing it today. They won 5 Emmys, 17 nominations. They've done The Sopranos, Entourage, Ballers, The Orville, a ton more movies, The Italian Job, Ted, Patriots Day, Rambo, Secretariat. So how's that? There's Sheila Jaffe.
There's Sheila Jaffe.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi, Sheila.
How are you?
Hi, I'm good. How are you guys?
I'm doing just fine. We're pretty good. Thank you for doing this, really. We're really
thanks
happy
for having
excited.
Us on the show.
Now, is Georgianne around? We got to get Georgianne back. There she comes.
There she comes.
Hey, Georgianne.
Welcome. Thank you for coming on today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. So you know, we've been doing the podcast, and we're up to episode 10, and we're doing a rewatch. So we're starting from the beginning, and we've had different guests on that made this show a success. So it's not just cast members and actors. It's the wardrobe and the hair and the casting and producers and on and on. So if I could get right from the beginning, how did The Sopranos come about? So you guys are doing it, and now it's 1997. The pilot is shot. So what?
Yeah.
Did you have to interview with David? Did he call you? How did that work?
Yeah, I was in LA. We were working in New York on tons of indie movies. And you know, we worked a lot with Alex Rockwell and Steve Buscemi when he directed. And we were just, you know, doing that. And then I went to LA to do a movie called Slums of Beverly Hills. And Georgianne did the New York end of it. And while I was there doing that, I got a call, I don't even know, from somebody, David Chase, you know, they wanted to send me the script. I think it was Susie Fitzgerald sent it to us, George,
wow.
Right?
Yeah, it was, yes.
From HBO,
and,
yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And I read it, and I thought it was really good. And I told Georgianne, I said, this is really good. And it was, at that time, it was Tommy Soprano. Remember, it wasn't Tommy.
That's right.
It was Tommy.
That's right.
And David, I guess, had been meeting people in L.A. He was based in L.A. And he had seen Tree's Lounge. And from what I was told, what Georgianne and I were told, he said, I want those girls. I want those girls that cast Tree's Lounge. Because it was so authentic and it was so good. And all those characters, so many of them wound up being in The Sopranos.
Yeah.
Suzanne Shepherd, you know.
Steve himself, Buscemi himself, who directed it and starred in it.
Of course, yes.
But at the time, David Chase wasn't David Chase. He was just a TV writer. So, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It wasn't like, you know, of course he became.
No, but he'd had notoriety from his first success.
He did.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember the name of the show. He had it on the air for Rockford Files.
Rockford Files, and then he was in Northern Exposure he had.
Yes, Northern Exposure, exactly.
So,
Those were big.
But we didn't know anything. Georgianne and I had been doing independent movies. We'd never done television. We didn't know what that would be like, what it would entail. And the actors that we were approaching were also indie actors, movie actors, and they didn't really understand what television was. HBO, I think the one big show at the time was Oz that Edie was in.
Yeah.
I don't think it was on the air yet. I think it was filming when we were, I don't know if it had hit the air
you
when
might
we were
be
doing
right.
the pilot.
You might be right.
I think they were in production, but they weren't, I'm not sure, but there were no hits on cable,
no.
That's for sure. No.
And people didn't want to do it. It was, at that time, which is so different now, it was actually a bad thing if you were a film actor to be known now as a TV actor. It was like a negative.
Right. Very separate worlds. And
yeah,
in a lot of ways,
people,
right?
Yeah.
And things have changed.
Oh my God, now everybody's on television.
Well, I guess because David saw, you know, wanted to bring a film, cinema-like quality to television. So that's why he brought you guys in, because he saw how specific the casting was, how authentic, how New York it was, and real.
And he also liked my accent.
That always helps.
You know what I mean? Like when I would say things like, you know, when I had to read for the people, when I read Melfi and the actors would be reading for Tommy Soprano, and I had to say, what kind of birds were they? I always said, from my Bronx roots, what were they, seagulls? Seagulls. He liked that, because I didn't know I didn't say seagulls, it was seagulls.
All right, so you get the script, you're starting to see people. How many people do you think you see for Tommy Soprano?
Oh my God, I wish I had that list, George. You know, our sessions.
But you got to remember, everybody had to be Italian. That list was long, but it wasn't that long. There were just a couple of really great guys that could have done it.
I think they're the usual suspects and a lot of unknown people, like a lot of those people that came to Cafe Central that hung out there that, you know, were character actors. I think they read, we read everybody that
everybody had to read, right?
Well, they had to read for David and they had to read for HBO. And I think, I'm not sure about this, you guys may know more. I am pretty sure HBO had David meet some namier actors at the beginning, and I don't think any of them fit the bill for him.
Uh-huh. And
that would have been before us, I think.
Yeah, before us. Yeah.
When did you first meet James Gandolfini?
Oh, well, that was in L.A. He read in New York, then he read in L.A., both. He came into the audition room in New York, and he actually sat there with the script and said, you know, this is more complicated than I thought it was going to be. I'm not ready to do this. Yeah. And then the next thing, he was in Los Angeles.
Then they flew Sheila to and L.A. Yep. I had done a little thing for the Sundance Labs where he played, because up to that point, he had only played heavies, you know, in True Romance and, you know, really tough guy. And this thing I did for the Sundance Lab was with him and Clea Duvall, where he played her hippie father. And it was just like, it was for the Writers Lab. So it was only like a 3-day thing. But I saw a side of him through that was fantastic. We cast him in that because he knew the director. So we knew, Georgianne and I knew, that he had the whole package to play this role. I mean, he was really our favorite idea from the beginning.
So it came down to, Michael had told the story and we had talked about it. This was before I was around, but came to Jim.
Michael Rispoli.
Steve Van Zandt were all tested to be Tony Soprano. Those were the three.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when Jim read in New York and then we flew him to L.A., it was just me, David, and Jim at David's house. Uh-huh. David ran the camera and I read. And it was VHS tapes. That's how long ago it was. And David and I ran back to his house, watched it. And we both got really excited. And then we had him come in and test for the network.
I was at that test at HBO because I met David in New York with you guys. And then they flew me and it was... I remember sitting in the waiting room at HBO and it was Edie, who I knew from other jobs, Lorraine, who I knew from Goodfellas vaguely, and then Jim Rispoli, and then this one guy who I looked familiar, but I couldn't recognize. And you walked up to me, Sheila, and you said, "That's little Steven Van Zandt." And I was like, "Ah," oh, because he had the Silvio hair, but the face was very, very familiar. And I was like, "Whoa, okay, that's pretty wild." But I remember being in that waiting room. Going in and testing.
You were the only one, though, I think, for Christopher.
At that test, yeah, I think so.
Yeah. When we read it, that was another one. You were like, you know, we were like, oh, Michael, right?
But you saw a lot of people for Christopher, no?
Yeah. When you're casting, like, look, casting directors sometimes could say that's the person for the role, but then we have to present to the director and to HBO. Don't forget, it was their first big thing. They needed to make sure no stone was unturned.
So what do you, but what do you, how many people are you seeing? 10, 20?
Lots. People that nobody's ever heard of, people that, you know, you accidentally saw in something in a small part, and you go, well, maybe, you don't know. But then you pre-screen them. You pre-screen everybody.
I even read somebody, I remember seeing Bronx Tale, and there was a guy at the end of Bronx Tale that kills the main character, the guy with the gun kills Lilo, right? I went crazy trying to find this guy. His name was Phil. He had never acted before. He was basically an extra. And I found him, and he came to LA, and we read him. I mean, and it was before IMDb. So you had to kind of remember and research how to find people.
Yeah, it was a little harder. I read something with Ray Liotta. He said that he was offered the role of Tony. Is that true?
That would be before us.
Before
so
you.
I don't know.
Yeah, way before us. That was never when we were on.
Later on, he was offered the role of Ralphie, I think, right? Do you remember that? Yeah, I think that I remember hearing that he was offered the role, him, Joey Pants. I think Bruno Kirby was up for it. Maybe
it's D'Onofrio, I think.
Bruno. Yeah.
I think Lorraine might have even told me they wanted her to play Carmella and she didn't want that. Is that true?
Maybe, but it was never said in front of me, and I don't know if it was said in front of Sheila.
Gotcha.
It wasn't. The only thing I knew that she wanted to do and read for was Melfi.
Yeah, Melfi. Yeah.
After the first season, like, who was the hardest part to cast, would you say, or one of the hardest roles?
So if we can go back to the pilot for a minute, this is a little known thing about the role of Hesh.
Oh, yeah.
That Georgianne and I know. Oh, so it was a Friday. You guys were going to shoot the pilot on Monday. They were trying to call Georgianne. I was in L.A. She was in New York, Connecticut. And she wasn't around. It was a weekend. And they reached me in L.A. saying, I could say who it was at this point.
Yeah, you can. Absolutely.
Jerry Stiller was Hesh. Yeah. And Jerry Stiller accepted a commercial on Friday and was not going to show up to work on Monday.
Wow.
Yeah. And out of a miracle, it so scary, and you know, just out of sheer, I don't know, luck, fate, whatever, purpose, destiny, I called Jerry Adler's daughter.
Her daughter, exactly. The daughter.
Elisa Adler, she was an agent. At Paradigm. Yeah. I said, where is your father? And he happened to be in New York. And he got the job.
Wow.
No, I don't. I don't think anybody ever knew that. It would have been a whole different.
Oh,
thing.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I can't even picture that. You know, one thing that I can't picture anyone in the roles except for the people that wind up playing them. I mean, that's just me. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, I can't see anyone being Hesh except for Hesh.
I know. It was, I think it worked out for the best.
It was perfect.
Jerry Stiller got a lot of money.
It was a blessed accident.
You know, because I think the pilot, Michael, you probably know, I don't think anybody made money. We certainly didn't. You know what I mean? I don't think anybody did.
And I'll be honest, I didn't really have high hopes for it. I liked, you know, I read the script. I liked it. I couldn't tell that it was going to be the greatest TV show ever. From the script, it's hard to tell the tone or where it was going. I like that you guys are doing it, and I like the cast, because there were a lot of actors that I had known and a lot of actors I admired. So I was excited about it. But like you said before, there weren't hit shows on cable.
No.
And it was violence, and there was profanity, and there was nudity. It's like, even after we did it, it's like, who's going to watch? Are people going to watch this? Is there an audience for this on television? I mean, I didn't really know.
Michael, they were doing everything you couldn't do on network.
Right.
Network couldn't show any of that.
Yeah.
That's why it was such a ball, you know, it was a blockbuster.
And I thought it was funny when I read it. I saw so much humor in it. even amidst the violence. And
oh, yes. Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. It was very funny.
Sheila, remember we went to the screening in L.A.? I'll never forget that because nobody was laughing in the theater except
really?
Me.
Really? Yeah.
No, really. And Sheila and I came out of there thinking, my God, this is the best thing since, you know, I don't know, whatever. But it was really an amazing experience to see the show up on the screen, the pilot.
It was always fun at the premiere seeing, well, everybody being together. And then like once the show hit and we started going to these really fancy places like Radio City and the Ziegfeld yeah. to screen the first episode of the season. It was amazing, right? Very exciting
amazing.
To see projected
amazing.
Up there.
The bus. And remember we all those... went to the Emmys and the bus.
Emmys oh, in yeah. the bus. Yes,
we did. and they had all those great parties. Brad Gray used to have those parties at his house.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh my God.
It was fun. It was a really fun show. It was a great cast. For me, it was so nice to get all these actors that we like so much these roles. Like one of my favorites was getting Sharon Angela that part because yeah. I just love her. And Michael, I think we knew her through your act. She was in acting class with you and yeah. I think John Ventimiglia.
That's
and
true.
And you guys
yeah.
told me there's a girl in our acting class you should know. I think it was when we were doing another movie with you. We were doing, I think it was On the Run.
On the Run, yeah, because Sharon was in that as well as John. That's
and
right.
And she's so authentic and, you know, I don't know. So people like that, it was very exciting. You know, yeah. to be Absolutely. Able to cast them.
After the show was a big hit, I bet you guys must have got a lot of incoming from agents about stars who wanted to be on the show. Did that start to happen, that people?
No, not really. No, not
it
really.
It didn't, no?
I was thinking about that yesterday. No. Every time I needed, you know, name value, I had to call them up personally and say, who have you got? Who's willing to do the show? Who's willing to read for David? It was tricky. Yeah.
But there was some
You'd have to
people,
bang the door down a little. Yeah.
There right. were some people that spoke privately to us saying I'd love to be on the show.
Who were just fans who were and just liked it.
Yeah, and they were kind of namey actors.
But yeah. let me ask you, every single person who appeared on The Sopranos read for David Chase.
Yes.
Wow. Not every like
You know, Ben Kingsley didn't read.
Yeah.
Right. No, I'm sorry. You know, when I had those people, no, I made
the
off.
Cameos.
I,
mean, yeah.
I know Lauren Bacall didn't read. I'm just saying.
Correct. That. But that was that one specific show, Stevie.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was
yeah,
that
yeah.
one show.
A guest
you know,
star thing. Yeah.
From the gift show.
So myself, now, Georgianne, I don't know what you remember or not remember, but I'm going to tell you what happened. So I was in New York for a wedding, and my agent at the time, I said, let me see if I can read for that show. It was in June of 99. So you were casting for the second season. And
yeah.
I went up, it was on Broadway. I met you in the office was on Broadway.
The like, Triangle Building, the Triangle yes. Building on Broadway. Yeah.
So I went up there on a Friday afternoon. The wedding was a Saturday. I got faxed the sides. It was for the role of Skip Lipari, which Louis Lombardi wound up doing. It was FBI agent. And I went in, and I was nervous. There was no one there, no one in the waiting room, just you. There was nobody there. And it was later on a Friday afternoon. And I read for the role of FBI agent, and you said, I don't see you as that. Now, calm down. You're nervous. It's just me and you here, which immediately calmed me down.
But, you know, oh, good. I'm so glad.
You went like this. You said, it's just me and you. What are you nervous about? I said, okay. You said, read this. We have someone in mind. It was the role of Bacala. You gave me a minute. I cold read it. You said, that was pretty good. Then you picked up my resume like this. You went, so what is this? and it was a couple lines here. You know, I had done some stuff. You know, I wasn't completely green. And you said, listen, this is a local hire. You know, it's a scale job. It's a local hire, blah, blah, blah. And I was living in Las Vegas at the time. And you said, if I could get you in front of David, would you come back? And I said, I guess. I didn't even really know who David was. So I came back a week later, and there was a ton of people at Silver Cup. I read with you. Sheila, I don't know if you were there or not. I hadn't met you at that point.
I don't think I was there.
There was about 15 people in the room. All kind, I guess, Robin and me. I mean, everybody was. Oh, yeah. There was a ton of people that I later. And David said that was very good. And the next, I had a flight. I flew to L.A. because I was doing some TV show. You called me personally on my cell phone at 8:30. It was 8:30 L.A. time. You said, I know I'm not supposed to be doing this. I'm supposed to call your agent. I just had to tell you how great you are. You did your work, and you got it. And I don't know if, and I was, I remember stepping outside the studio, and it was like, besides my two kids being born, that's a fantastic phone call to get. So I don't know if you remember that, but that's what you
did. I do. Yeah, I do.
And that was incredible. Yeah. Incredible. You know, you changed my life, that's for sure. You know.
When one can do that, one's a happy camper. What can I say?
That's true. It's like, it's, you know, it is true.
It's so nice when people do that. Yeah, I agree.
Do you guys remember the open call that we had out in Jersey?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And we got run over by people, literally, and we got closed down by the police.
They had to shut the police, yeah.
Harry Bronstein was there, and he was having a hemorrhage because there were so many people. Guys showed up in costume.
Yeah.
Play guns, and they were doing scenes out on the street. It was interesting.
Some of them were dressed like guys and dolls too. They weren't like in. They were wearing like pinstripes and white ties.
Singing.
I'm not kidding.
Yeah, no.
But you got one.
It blew my mind away. But we had more than 5,000 pictures.
Wow.
And we would go through them just to see for extras, for you know, for the you know, David wanted people in the funeral parlor. People wanted here. We had all these people, and they looked real. That's what was so great about that thing. But that was a crazy day.
That was one of the most successful open calls ever, because sometimes an open call can only have one person show up.
One person, you know? Exactly.
But it was a phenomenon at that point. Sopranos was a phenomenon. People were crazy for it.
They cast Denise Barino from that open call, who played Ginny Sack, right?
Ginny Sack, one of the only people
who got a real speaking part out of the open call.
That's true.
Probably got a lot of extras.
I tell you, if Meredith and Kathleen hadn't been there to sort out everything after that epic day, we couldn't have found anybody. You know, we remembered, we made notes. We had a guy show up with 6 pizzas as a pizza delivery.
That's
just
nice.
So he could get in.
There you go. That's a good move. That's a good move. I like it.
And nobody had ordered pizza, and we're all looking at each other. You know, it was wonderful, really. Amazing days.
Was there ever anyone you tried to get on the show, cast, or come in to read that just flat out wouldn't? Someone that you really thought was right and you just couldn't get them. You remember?
No.
I remember somebody reading and then not accepting it and taking another part instead. But no, most of the people we asked to read read.
How did Peter Bogdanovich wind up on the show?
Friends of David.
Peter was a friend of David.
Friend of David. Yep. Yep.
I didn't know the guy
who played the guy, Sheila, I don't know, maybe you remember, the guy who was narcoleptic, the guy who fall asleep standing up. I just saw him by.
Turk Pipkin.
That was another friend of David's.
Oh, really?
You know,
I didn't know that. Yeah. He was really good.
He's a Texas guy. Yeah, he's good. Yeah.
Austin. He's from Austin.
The other killer was David gives, he called me and he said, what about Stevie Van Zandt? This was at the beginning. And I said, okay, sure. And he said, do you know how to get a hold of him? And I went, I don't know, but I'll find out. And back then there was a thing called celebrity service at the agency.
Right.
I got Stevie's cell phone. I called him on the golfing. He was playing golf. And the first thing out of his mouth is, how did you get this number? But I'll never forget, when he walked in to audition for David, he was dressed as the character.
Everybody that read for the role wound up in it. Michael Rispoli wound up in it.
Yeah, yeah.
So David cast a lot of people that read. Toni Kaelum wound up in it. She read for Carmella.
Uh-huh.
And she got another part.
Oh, I didn't know that. Uh-huh. And Also, David, so as you're going along, right? Now, David, we know, is precise and he wants what he wants. That was that tough at times? I mean, yes. David wants what he wants.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. I mean, right? I mean, this show didn't happen by accident. So he's calling.
I brought in Patty McCormick, whose last name was Russo when she was a kid. She was the bad seed girl.
The bad seed.
And the first thing David
said to me, yeah, she played Adriana's mother. The first thing he said, she's not Italian. I said, yes, she is. She's from New York. She's Italian. Honest to God, cross my heart, hope to die. Wow. So it was, yeah, you know, you're always.
And, it was also.
And, Federico. Federico was the other one. He had to be really Italian. And he really was Italian.
Yeah.
And I remember him making everybody. He had a casting session in Italy that, you know, we sent out sides. We did the whole thing. He didn't find what he wanted. He hired Federico.
Wow.
You know,
from
New Jersey.
Also. He was very specific, and when the people came in to read, rarely, if ever, did you get a second chance. You read it, and thank you.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Yeah.
And there was
so
one
many
time,
people in the room.
But there were a lot of people in the room. A
lot of people.
Always a lot of opinions and a lot of voices. Yeah. But David ultimately, you know. And David respected when you made a case for somebody. Like, there was somebody that I convinced him to see again because I knew she could do better. She didn't wind up getting the part, but he said, you know, if you reasoned with him, you know, he would hear that.
Yeah.
But they did see, I mean, we know like Nikki Sandow and numerous people,
yeah.
Joe Maruzzo. I mean, they read, some of these guys read 5, 6, 7, 8 times for different roles.
Different roles.
You liked them, but they never, well, Joe did, but Nikki, who's our dear friend and a terrific actor, he never got anything on the show.
No.
You know, but he kept coming back, so obviously he liked them. It's just...
Well, you know. But also, you know, there was a point in time where we had run out, literally run out of people to bring in for certain things. And I had to go back in and look at people we had used to bring back.
Uh-huh.
And in fact, it worked. You know, it did work.
All right.
And that was at David's request. So I did that. But, you know, it became difficult because there weren't enough different people. That's when I started hitting up on you guys and your families.
Right.
You weren't enough guineas.
Yeah.
You ran to all the Italians.
It was not enough guineas.
You know, hey.
But we were lucky. We got a lot of people we really liked always. And it was great also that Steve Buscemi wound up in the show. For us, that was great because that's how we got the job by
Without
working
him,
with him.
Yeah, we wouldn't have gotten the job
that
at
came
all.
Around.
It was wonderful.
Yeah.
And then, goes around, comes around.
And then after, I would assume once you do The Sopranos now, everyone's banging your door down for work. I probably had more work than you could handle. Am I right?
No.
No?
No,
we were busy. We worked a lot. We worked steadily. We really did. And I'm sure, yes, The Sopranos absolutely helped.
You know?
So it didn't translate immediately into like all the film studios wanting to hire you to do movies. It didn't,
No, because that was still a different thing, movies.
Right.
Yeah.
The movies I got really were from working on The Slums of Beverly Hills at Fox. And then Fox kept hiring me. It was a very different thing. It still is for casting people. The deals they make with us, everything, television. You know, you do a movie, same for actors. Like you do the movie, you're done. That's it. That character's gone. Jim Gandolfini used to say that we ruined his life. He said, he remembered Georgianne in that video. He did this tribute to us and he said, Sheila and Georgianne, they told me to come in, read for this. It's a pilot. Nobody's going to see it. He said, they ruined my life.
Have any of you seen the movies he did, the independent movies he did after we stopped working?
Oh, sure, The Draft.
He did one, Dreyfus, and oh my God, they were amazing.
It was great.
They were amazing.
I think that was his last movie, the one with Louis Dreyfus. And that was the closest to Jim being Jim there, I think, you know?
Yeah.
So we all know what a good guy he was. And
the greatest.
I think that was the closest one. Yeah.
The greatest.
Had a good heart.
He was a good captain of the ship you guys were all on. You know what I mean? He,
no doubt. I think without a doubt.
He loved you all, and he was so respectful and loved his his actors, and he was a team player.
For sure.
He was a team player. But more, remember when he wouldn't go back to work until you guys all got a raise? His agent went after money for him. And he said, oh, no, not just me, everybody. Am I wrong about that?
No, he gave us all a check, which we talked about. He gave us all check for $33,000 each.
Jeez.
16 people, the main cast. He called us into his, he always watched out. I mean, I remember at one point, money-wise, we were in a negotiation and it got a little ugly. And Jim was, whatever you guys want to do, he was in, you know.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
He was
amazing.
In.
I remember his manager locked down on us, and he wouldn't come back to work.
Yeah,
it's not like in the second season when Nancy passed away, and we had to put everything on hold. My God, how they pulled that funeral scene together! I'll never figure that one out. That thing was enormous.
But then when we shot the scene after the funeral in the Soprano house. And we're all in like the living room.
Oh, that was good.
And they play the song from Carousel, and we all just died laughing.
Yeah.
It was horrible. Yeah. Like we're supposed to be serious, but they play this song, If I Love You, which is very schmaltzy, hot, you know, falsetto or whatever, you know, voice. And we just couldn't get it together. The whole, like everybody though, like all of us. Jesus. I mean, it was just Suzanne Shepherd and Stevie Van Zandt and Dre DiMatteo and Edie. I mean, it was just, and Jerry Adler. We could not stop laughing. It was, and in some ways, it was the best send off in a way for Olivia and for Nancy because she was so beloved. But it was,
it was kind of amazing to think, had she lived, the different turn the show would have taken, you know?
Yeah, yeah, no doubt. I mean, it's something to think about because, I mean, the show really stems from that relationship. Now, the whole show really is about, you know, this guy's, he's going to therapy because of his mother, basically, and all these issues.
Yeah,
and
she was the protagonist. She was the main protagonist.
Yeah.
My God.
Then that, but that opened it up for Aida to have
a
bigger role, right? I mean, Aida's role.
Yeah.
Really grew after that. She came back and
of course she had to become the brains, the evil one, the conniver, you know. I always thought it was like a Lady Macbeth kind of role.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Sure. Did you see a lot of people for that, for Janice Soprano?
You know, we saw more in LA, I think.
Right.
Yes, you did. Yes.
I saw a lot of like actresses in LA, and I think the final call back in New York I remember two people, and I know there was a third, and I can't remember who that was.
Man, was she perfect for that part, though. God, I mean, that's just like
great.
Well, and her and Jim had the best relationship because they were friends.
They did Streetcar
together, right?
And a movie, I think, too.
Angie. Yeah. Oh, yeah, Angie. And they really, really liked each other.
And they fought like brother and sister for real. I was in the...
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, what?
You remember
Robin?
Perfect. Oh, sorry. You remember Robin Green, the writer?
Sure.
Robin? Yeah, at the rap party from the season before, she came up to me. We've been drinking, obviously. And she said, Georgianne, I don't want to surprise you, but there's going to be a sister. And I went, oh my God, it's got to be Aida. And then, you know, then the process started. The whole process began.
Well, because
you know,
there
got to see everybody.
There were two sisters.
We had Marcia Gay Harden in. Remember?
Really?
Yeah, that's the other one that came in. Okay,
so she was terrific. Yeah.
And Aida was at, Aida will tell the story because Aida told me, she said, I'll never forget walking into that room to read. And I saw Marcia Gay Harden in the waiting room. She said, and that was like one of my favorite actresses. And she said, I can't do this. Like, they give it to Marcia.
Now, Dominic, which I'm sure you know Dominic a long time. Wonderful. Yeah. One of our favorite people ever. Everyone will agree to that. So I believe Joe Vitarelli told me he read for that.
He probably did. Yeah.
So Rico told us he read for that. And Frank Vincent said he read for that.
They all probably did. It's a long time ago. I can't remember, but a lot of people went for it.
Steve.
But But
sorry, it was like a chess game. You just kept moving the people around until they got in the right hole.
Yeah.
That's the way I looked at it.
But
you know,
it was very practical. But nobody was hitting it. Nobody. And we read a lot of people in LA also. Well, I think Joe Vitarelli was in LA. Yeah, because yes, he used to go to the Friars Club. He took me one time to meet Milton Berle.
Yeah.
Honestly, he did. It was funny. But David kept saying, I remember he kept saying to me, there's got to be somebody that we don't recognize, you know, that hasn't been in all the other Goodfellas, or maybe somebody in another movie. And all of a sudden, I just never forget, I just went, I know somebody who was in a movie, had a small part, Johnny Ola. But I didn't know his name. I just remember Johnny Ola. And I was like, I know who. It's Johnny Ola. And then I had to like find out who played Johnny Ola. And then the rest
that's
is history.
Perfection. Just perfection.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Because he wasn't recognized, you know, like when you see The Godfather, it's not like Johnny Ola isn't the main person that comes to your mind.
Oh, and tell me about the first time you met the wonderful Tony Sirico.
Well, I met him at the restaurant.
I
knew him as Junior Sirico at the restaurant.
Don't call me Junior.
Watches this now, it'll probably kill me. But no, he used to come in with Tony Conforti and Joe Cortez and I forget who else, but he was in that Cafe Central every night.
Hanging out where it was an actor hangout.
Yes.
Is that where Bruce Willis was a bartender?
Yes.
And John Goodman, they were bartenders, right?
No, John Goodman was a bar customer.
Oh, okay.
And Bruce was the bartender, and I was the hostess, and then I became the manager.
Well, right, listen, guys. We could talk to you forever, but we're going to go into the episode and start talking about
it. I couldn't thank you enough for changing my life, both of you. And hopefully we'll see you soon.
Guys.
Thank you both. Bye-bye. We love you.
Stay safe.
Thank you.
Love you
too.
You
guys.
Bye, guys.
Take care.
All right, pal. They were great. This is good.
Yeah, great ladies. I would not have had the career that I have if it wasn't for them. I'll be honest with you.
They have been
instrumental in my career. Instrumental.
We would not be talking right now.
No.
If it wasn't for them. And also, some of the stuff, they got incredible stories. It's amazing. Just amazing. I'm so glad they did this. And we've got many more great guests before and coming, and everyone who's made this show a success, not just the actors, you know, and there's so many moving parts. People don't realize there's hundreds of people literally that make a success or a failure. And you know,
Season 1, Episode 10, A Hit is a Hit. It's another standalone episode, similar to College, because, you know, the tension that's been building in Season 1 with now Junior being the boss and the feds, they suspect a rat. The feds are, onto the family, handing out indictments. The intrigue with Livia and all that tension is kind of gone. It's pretty much gone for this episode.
Yes.
And we have the stories that exist in this show are just for this show and pretty much go away, really. This was written by a guy named Joe Basso, along with Frank Renzulli. Frank, you know, wrote a bunch in the first two seasons. Joe Basso only was a writer on this episode and comes from the music world, which I think is why he was a writer on this one, because it focuses on the music world. He was a musician himself and a journalist who is the editor at Guitar World magazine, still writes articles for, very technical kind of guitar articles in music magazines. And I think he was worked at Island Records at a time as an A&R guy. Directed by Matthew Penn, who I've worked with a bunch of times. He was on Law & Order, I think the showrunner. I mean, he was an exec producer, director at Law & Order. I went... During the run of The Sopranos, Jesse Martin and Jerry Orbach were the lead detectives on Law & Order. Jesse is a friend of mine. He wanted to go off and do Rent, the movie, because he originated one of the roles on Broadway. And they invited me to replace him for like 6 episodes as one of the main detectives. And they worked it out with HBO. And I worked a lot with Matt Penn. as well as when he, I did a show called Detroit 187 and Matthew Penn directed there. He also did Blue Bloods. Lots of television, comes from a theater background, but his father was Arthur Penn, who directed Bonnie and Clyde.
Oh.
And his uncle, Arthur's brother, was Irving Penn, the very famous, you know, photographer. So he comes from this great artistic family and is a very good director and a really, really cool guy who I like a lot.
And Frank Rizzulli, another great episode. This is, I think, his third one of this season. Another great episode. Frank, early on, I don't know when he wasn't there the entire run, was he, Frank?
No, only the first two seasons.
First two, maybe three?
I don't know about the third season.
But this is another great episode. There's no Olivia. There's no Junior. There's no kids.
Yeah, it's a standalone. It really is, an episode unto itself. Like, it's, you know, some of the other episodes continue along the storyline and the tensions building about all the pressures. And this one just is kind of a break to all those things.
And this is Adriana, played by the great Dre DiMatteo. This is her breakout episode, you know, on the show, a series regulars and stuff. At some point you have this big episode that really introduced, even though we've seen her before, this is her big episode. And she is fantastic in it. And you see what she could really do right here. She is fantastic in it. And the audience sees, oh, this girl started out as a hostess, but, you know, sidekick, she's no longer right here, you know.
She had a bit in Legend of Tennessee Multisante. She had a few more scenes that, you know, where she got to act. And I think it became clear she was very, very talented. And they gave her the ball here and let her run with it.
And what we had... What we have here, the star of it, and we'll talk as we go along, but it's Bokeem Woodbine is the star. He plays...
Massive genius, yeah. Bokeem and I did a movie called Dead Presidents, directed by the Hughes brothers, maybe 4 years before The Sopranos. And we played soldiers. We played Marine Reconnaissance Unit. It was me, Bokeem, Chris Tucker, Sticky Fingers from the band Onyx, Lorenz Tate, a couple other actors. And we were, we spent about a month together in Orlando, and we had to train about a month and a half. In the first 2 weeks, we had to train in the woods with Captain Dale Dye, who had become like the guy who would train people for the movies to play anything involving the military. He did Platoon and Born on the 4th of July, like big movies. So we had to go into the woods for like a week and a half or 2 weeks, sleeping there with weapons. Yeah, there were times we had live ammo shooting targets. We were in camo. Not only that, but we were sleeping outside with no tents. And it was winter in Orlando and it was fucking freezing. I mean, I think it was like in the 40s or 30s at night, no tents.
Really?
Which just... Yeah, just on the ground with the bedroll, with like your poncho, you'd tie it to trees to make like a little shelter at night. I mean,
what was the purpose?
To learn how to be a, you know, to learn how to act like a soldier.
Well, I hope you get paid a lot of money.
It was so cold you couldn't sleep. So after a few days, 3-4 days of not sleeping, you start getting a little delirious. Half of the cast went AWOL. Uh-huh. And couldn't take it and left and ran, I don't know where they went, through the woods, and just Chris Tucker went AWOL. He couldn't do the it was pretty intense, man. So I knew Bokeem. We spent a lot of time together and he's been in a lot of TV. He was in Ray, the movie Ray with Jamie Foxx and tons of good stuff, but so it was cool to work with him again on this.
Yeah, I did a movie with him in 1998 called The Runner. Ron Eldard, Courtney Cox, John Goodman, Joe Montaigne. I played the role of a pit boss. I had a couple days on it. It was shot on the Utah-Nevada border. It was supposed to take place in Vegas. It was about gambling and bookmakers and runners. And they did the exteriors in Vegas, the interior in this casino. And I was there for a couple days. And we went out one night, you know, the cast, and we had a lot of fun. He's a really good guy. And the guy who wrote the movie, The Runner, it's a so-so movie. But this Anthony Zeiker was running the tram between Treasure Island and the Mirage in Vegas. His mother was a blackjack dealer. He grew up in Vegas, went to college. Really no aspirations to become a writer, but he bought a program how to write a screenplay. So he wrote
like Christopher, same thing.
So he wrote this thing called The Runner, and he sold it, and it was made, and out of nowhere. I mean, somebody got it to somebody. Somebody paid $35,000 for it, and it got made. Like I said, the director was very so-so, and he went on to create CSI.
Who, the Anthony writer or the Thaker, director?
The writer, CSI. Wow. And obviously was a show run on one of them. He's very successful, really good guy. Grew up in Vegas, went to high school there. Just an ordinary guy who stayed at it, got an agent from getting the movie made, and boom. So
that's
there you
cool.
go. Don't give up the ship, my friends.
Yeah, yeah.
Could happen to anyone at any time.
Someday your ship may come in, like it does in the first scene of the episode here with our boys dressed as maintenance men, delivery guys. Paulie, Pussy, Christopher. In the hallway, in the apartment building, pretending they're delivering a refrigerator. They're wearing a uniform that says Navasink, which is the river. It's actually the name Navasink comes from the Lenape tribe. They were a group, subset of the Lenape Native American tribe. And it's that's what they were on their uniforms, Navasink. But anyway, they're delivering a refrigerator, apparently, or supposedly.
Supposedly, and then they push the guy in. Yeah, Christopher puts his hand over his mouth. He's not wearing a glove. DNA would have been all over that, but that's not here nor there. They push him into the room. Paulie has a little talking with him, tells him to stay out of Jersey. Obviously, they're not listening, so he's sending a message. He shoots the guy between the eyes. They make a big score. They find it.
Big, big score. Unexpectedly big. They weren't expecting to get as much money as they got on this one.
So, you know, Pussy says crackheads and small bills. So they got money all over the place. And there you have it. Soprano, we're at the house.
It's a great line that Paulie has. Juan Valdez has been separated from his donkey.
Yes. So Tony's talking to Cusumato, the neighbor, who is a square... An annoying.
That's Robert Lapone, who is the brother of Patty Lapone, the famous Broadway star. But Bobby Lapone went to Juilliard, trained as a dancer, Martha Graham dancer, and then went into acting. He musical theater. He was one of the original cast of Chorus Line. He was nominated for a
Tony. Oh, really?
Yeah, 1976, the part of Zach. I think he originated that on Broadway. He was also the artistic director. I know him from this. He was artistic director of MCC, Manhattan Class Company, which was a really great off-Broadway theater company. I did a few readings for them before The Sopranos, and I knew him from that theater. And he's
done six Soprano episodes. He plays a really good role here. And Tony,
yeah, really good role, very specific, and he nails this.
Tony gives him a box of Cuban cigars, and for recommending Melfi, and. Cusumato goes, they're Cubans. Oh, they're illegal. Right away, he's got to go there with it. You know, guy's a fucking schmuck. Not my kind of guy at all.
Right, but he likes that they're illegal. It's exciting. Yes. He likes this association. It's a bit of a jock sniffing kind of
absolutely
scenario. He gets rough around the edges when he's with Tony.
And you know, he's a square, and Tony gets the call about Juan Valdez has been separated from his donkey, and he's listening. He sees what's going on here, and he says to Tony, why don't you join the country club? You know, he mentions to Tony that, you know, maybe once we get closer to Tony. He's a little, it's like having a, if you're a baseball fan, maybe you're having a, you know, a star player living next door to you. He wants to get close to him, you know?
Yeah, at least for now. At this point, he does. I don't Absolutely. Think he's thinking it through per se. But,
so we're in the apartment. Tony, Chris, Paulie, they're in robes. There's lots of money. Irene is there. Tony's Gomata. You got Paulie. He's got his girl. They're wearing bathrobes. And they're happy and excited and drinking champagne. And Paulie says, this will be the end of Rico when Christopher is going to go, correct?
Christopher doesn't hang out with them and party, you know, I guess would be partying with a hooker or something like that. And Christopher wants to be with Adriana. He wants to, you know, which shows that he's leaning towards being more serious with her taking that step. And yeah, Tony, Paulie says, could this be the end of Rico? That's a quote from Little Caesar, Edward G. Little Robinson. Caesar.
And then Tony says, listen, you got to put this money in an IPO, put it in the stock market, let it work for you, get the dividends. He's given Christopher a little advice. Don't go out and piss this money away. Let this money work for you.
Christopher, and very affectionate to Christopher in that moment. Yes. You see that fatherly feel, you know, that fatherly vibe that he has, Tony has towards Christopher in that scene.
Christopher and Adriana, he takes it to a Broadway play.
Rent. I just mentioned Rent. That was, he probably went to see Jesse Martin be in Rent back then. And they also went to Le Cirque.
Yeah.
Actually, the owner and the founder of Le Cirque just passed away the other day, yeah. Ciro Macchione, who Le Cirque was a very cool, very fancy restaurant. Actually,
yeah, but I didn't think it was great. I went there a few times.
Great vibe, though. Very cool.
Yeah, but the
I went there. Ronnie Wood and his wife took Victoria and I there for dinner.
The food was very ordinary. R.I.P. Cereo. I met his sons. They're terrific guys. Food
Great
was
desserts. Ordinary.
I was at Howard, without drop, I sound like a fucking asshole name dropper here, but Howard Stern got married there. And me and my wife, Laura, we were invited to the wedding because I work with Beth, you know Beth, and it was a fantastic wedding at Le Cirque, but the food was so-so, but I just wanted to throw that in
Fantastic
there for no reason
dessert,
whatsoever.
Dessert cart. Amazing desserts.
All right.
But a really cool vibe. A very New York place. Doesn't exist anymore. Actually, you know, Danielle Ballou, that's where he started.
Sure, he started? Well, listen, dinner then was probably solid $300-$400 for the two of them.
Probably.
Even
so he
back
takes,
then.
Adriana, he really wants to make, you know, this work with Adriana. I think he's getting deeper into the relationship with her and, you know, wants to make her happy. So he takes her to a burger joint in the South Bronx, which is where we shot that. That little burger stand was in the South Bronx near Yankee Stadium.
But I think it's supposed to be in Times Square, no? After the play. I think after the play,
maybe
I would say after the play, you know, they got all the burger joints in Times Square. What?
Probably,
you know,
that makes sense.
But you shot it in the South Bronx. So Christopher is just, he's crazy. He's got crazy balls. He's insulting. He's impatient. Hairnet Central, just derogatory, racist, fucking shit. You know,
probably because he has a gun on him.
Oh,
that's
I'm
why
sure.
he would say stuff like that. Yeah.
I'm sure. Talking shit. They finally, you know, call him to the front. He says it's about time. Massive Genius?
Massive Genius is Bokeem Woodbine's character, who's a famous rapper that Adriana kind of recognizes. Christopher doesn't recognize him, but she does. And one of my favorite outfits for Christopher, that great red sport jacket and the black shirt.
I've seen you wear that out at night. I've seen you in that. You took that home.
I don't own that one, but it is a really nice. And Dre's wearing a red dress. They actually look really good.
So who do you think Massive Genius, who is it? Supposed to be Puff Daddy, maybe?
Probably. Somebody like that,
Puff Daddy, Dr. Dre, Diddy.
Master P at that time was doing movies. That guy, maybe like a P. Diddy. It's before Kanye West.
Damon Dash, famous. maybe Damon Dash, somebody on that.
Probably before he was famous either. I mean, yeah. P. Diddy was pretty famous then. Yeah. I actually wound up having a meeting with P. Diddy.
Oh, he's a good guy. Good guy.
During the Sopranos. I had a meeting with him for a movie. There was a book by George Pelicanos called King Suckerman that George Pelicanos wrote for The Wire and Homicide and The Deuce and a lot of books. And P. Diddy and Harvey Weinstein got the rights to it. And they hired me to adapt it, actually.
Did he try to grab your cock, Harvey, when you went in there? Did he hold you down and grab your cock?
No, he wasn't known for that. No, he was not known for his approaching men that way.
Okay.
But they never wound up making that movie. It's a really great book. But I worked for both of them on that. And P. Diddy grew up a few blocks away from me in Mount Vernon, New York.
He grew up middle-class guy.
He's a little younger than me, but lived near me. And took me to Patsy's for our meeting about this project. That's where we went for lunch.
He's a good guy. I've met him a bunch of times. Very respectful, well-spoken, and
smart
very
guy.
Talented and very intelligent guy and a good guy. Okay, so he comes over. They meet each other. The security guard tells him that Christopher's hooked up with Tony Soprano, with the Soprano crew, blah, blah, blah. He steps outside. Hey, Donnie Brasco, Orange J, played by Brian Hicks. He says there's some business to be had. Christopher is intrigued.
Yeah, Christopher likes being treated like a gangster here. Yeah. This guy's inviting him, and he kind of feels like, you know, important. And you know, guys are celebrities, inviting them to a party. They decide to go. You know, they're a little impressed. It's a big mansion and a big, you know, this is kind of the circles I think that Christopher and Adriana want to run in some ways, show business and, you know, high society and I think.
Inglewood Cliffs, which I believe is where Eddie Murphy had that big house.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Bubble House or something like that. I believe. Now, let me ask you something. So they go to Massive's office, right? And Christopher's, Massive says something. They said, what a gorgeous house, Adriana says. And he says, it's bigger than Stevens. Who does he mean?
Spielberg. Because at the time, Spielberg had a big mansion in the Hamptons back then. I don't know if he still does. And it was very,
So as Sirico would say, yeah. Stevie Spielberg.
I think it was Spielberg. He also brings up Alec Baldwin.
Who was a huge fan of the show.
And a friend of Jim's. They did Streetcar Named Desire together with Aida and Jim Gandolfini before The Sopranos. Alec was in an acting class that I was in at one time.
And he was a big fan of the show.
Big fan.
He interviewed David, and they mentioned him twice. We'll talk about it later on. So Chris, there's the machine gun, and
he shows him a customized Desert Eagle with a scope on it and a laser, and he points it at Christopher, like kind of like intimidating.
But it's a veiled threat.
But absolutely. That gun is a very high end. Fancy gun. Chris actually uses it in 46 Long when they hijack the truck. Chris has a Desert Eagle. And the Russian guy in the Pine Barrens also has a Desert Eagle. So the gun shows up a few times.
So they have, you know, he mentions Godfather 1, Godfather 2, and he says, and Godfather 3, most people don't like it, but I think it's misunderstood. He explains that Hesh stole royalties from little Jimmy Willis, who's a distant cousin. He's got an aunt that Hesh holds the money. And Christopher says, I doubt very much if Hesh is going to give up the money.
Well, he says Hesh is a sweet guy, but I've heard his position on giving back pieces of Israel.
Yeah.
You know, and what's weird is Christopher gets this sit down to happen. So I really wish they would have shown that scene of Christopher trying to convince Tony and Hesh to meet this guy and have a sit down about this, because it's pretty
Probably Christopher didn't tell him what it was about. I don't think he said, listen, this guy says you owe him money, blah, blah, blah. I don't think that's how it went down.
No, you're right. He probably had to hustle him and say it's about business. He wants to do business with us. He's a big, rich guy. Money.
Yeah, we went to the house, a mansion. Okay, so they're at the apartment. And Chris goes, that guy's a gangster. I'm a gangster. I'm an OG original. He's pissed off. I'll think, you know, you explain to Adriana, the Italians once ruled the music business, which they did. The Rascals, Dion,
Frankie Valli.
He says that your father was involved in it. You're saying we got to worry all this secret shit with the Sopranos. Junior's moldy sweaters. And, you know, the mob, which they did with Paola, they once ran the record business and shook down people and threatened DJs in order to play their music. I think Christopher is a new wave. He's younger than everyone else. He would much rather be that kind of a gangster, like Massive Genius, than sitting in a pub. He says, I sit in a fucking pork store all day.
Yeah, what do I got? I sit in a pork store, for Christ's sake. And it's true. You know, he doesn't want to be like a Paulie Walnuts. That life for him, just that, to aspire to that doesn't mean much for Chris.
Well, it also tails into when he said, where's my life, in earlier episodes? I need an arc in my life.
Where's my arc?
Yeah. You know, so
not enough.
I mean, listen, this guy's in this huge house driving, what was that, a Rolls Royce or a Bentley?
Rolls Royce or Bentley.
You know. Now back to the Soprano house. Carmela tells Tony that they're invited to a barbecue, and he says, "Ooh, the mayonnaise is up the street," meaning white people, Americans. And a lot of Italians don't like mayonnaise. Do you like mayonnaise?
For certain things.
I do, but a lot of Italians, like my uncles, never would ever in the house, they would. You know, I always liked it, you know, my mother, you know.
For certain things. I mean,
a lot of hardcore Italians, mayo in the house is a big no-no. And you know, listen.
I don't know. Turkey sandwich, what are you going to put on turkey?
Mustard. Have I ever steered you wrong when I've told you things? I ever steer you wrong? Look it up.
Where am I going to look that up? where should I? Where, is there an encyclopedia on... Where am I going to look that up? Well, I believe you, but certain things, do they eat coleslaw? That has mayo in it.
A lot of them don't like coleslaw. They don't like the mayo.
They don't eat pussy either. Those are probably the same guys who don't eat mayo.
They certainly wouldn't eat it with mayo on it. That's
right. Forget it. Now that's mustard, maybe.
All right, so Tony says they got enough for college. She's looking at brochures, and this has been a theme. It goes through the entire series about who's going to take care of me. He said, don't worry, you'll be taken care of. And where's the security? This is until the end. We see
Carmela. For good reason, for yes. Very good reason. Sure.
And she says, well, did you make a score? And he's got ate the canary look on him. No, I wish.
And why does he say no?
Because he doesn't want to. You know, maybe he doesn't. If he says yes, his next question is how much? And then he's got to explain to her where the money goes and is. He doesn't want to tell her where the money is.
No, I think it's because he doesn't want her spending. Because if he says yes, she's going to go off and buy some, you know, fancy.
All of the above.
Artwork or furniture or who knows what.
She says, I don't know if you're old fashioned, paranoid, or just an asshole. And who's going to take care of her? Good. It's a running theme. If he dies, if he goes to jail, and you know that story, somebody's supposed to take care of, but they never do, it seems like, right?
No, and that's a likely outcome of being in that life, going to jail or dying young. You know, that's very common. So she's smart to be thinking this way.
They're in the restaurant. Christopher is waiting.
Adriana is a hostess, which we see her in the pilot as a hostess. So yes. She's still continuing this job. She, she's talking about this band and her guy she used to grow up with, she used to date. The name of the band was Defiler.
Yeah, but the, what I love is Christopher right away. You remember Richie Santino? Well, the guy used to fuck.
Of course. Of course. He's jealous, like most men. But the band was called Defiler. Actually, there is a band now called Defiler, a deathcore band. Defiler, such a weird name. But now they're called Visiting Day. So they're going from a heavy metal thing to more of an alternative 90s vibe. She thinks they're great and that this could be, her way of having a career, having some interest not just being a hostess. She's aspiring to something, making money and having a career, which is cool, you know.
And Chris's ears perk up. He's receptive to what she's saying, you know. And,
yeah.
Now they're, you know.
And I think he does want something good for her. I think he also wants to make her happy. He wants her to be happy in a genuine sense. It's not just his own seeing the angle of possibly making money and liking this aspect of, you know, a branch of the mob and in the music business. But I think he also sees, you know, that it could be good for her and good for their relationship.
Chris, back at the apartment, Chris, they're listening to Defiler's demo. And Christopher says, fuck it, let's go. But I get to pick out what you wear. I like that. Also, she says, maybe Alec Baldwin will come to our house. That's the second time they mention Alec Baldwin. So she's hoping, get into music management. Chris is going to finance it. She knows about this stuff. And she's very happy that Chris has the confidence in her and to get into this world. The next thing, they're at the Hesh's horse farm. Massive Genius and Hesh talk about the music business and massive questions, Hesh. So you and little Jimmy wrote it. Who wrote the lyrics? Who wrote the music? And Hesh is lying.
Well, he says, I got a gelding named Sydney. He goes, oh, why not write a song about that? Well, he's baiting him because he knows Hesh probably didn't write any of the songs. And that, this little Jimmy Willis, you know, and there was a great musician who used to go by the name Little Jimmy Scott, eventually just changed it to Jimmy Scott, who I wonder if this is somewhat based on. Little Jimmy Scott had a big career in the 50s and 60s and sang, you know, with a lot of the great musicians of the day. He was a favorite of Billie Holiday's, and I think he sang with Frank Sinatra one time. And then he had some contract dispute with a Jewish, I guess, half a wise guy, and his career just, by the end of the 60s, he became a porter in a hospital for like 20 years.
Really?
Yeah. And then had a resurgence again in the 80s because of Doc Pomus, a famous songwriter who rediscovered him basically. And then from the 80s till he died, I think in 2014, I got to see him perform a few times, got to meet him. Just an incredible voice. He had a strange disease when he was young and it prevented him from reaching puberty actually. So his voice, and he was very small. Uh-huh. And his voice kind of had this androgynous quality to it that's very haunting. If you ever get a chance to hear his music, but he went by the name Little Jimmy Scott. I'm wondering if this character was based on him. But anyway,
and
if you haven't heard his music, you should.
One of the earlier episodes, Tony talks to Hesh, and he said, who you kidding? You know, he says, if I, when Junior wanted the big tax, I forget what episode it's in, but when Junior wanted a tax Hesh, he says, I'm going to quit. I'm going to leave the area and I'll just live off my royalties. And Tony says to him, who are you kidding? You just put your name on those fucking records. He tells him. So we've heard this before, what Hesh is all about, you know.
Right. This happened a lot.
Yeah. You know, he tells, they talk business. Massive wants $400,000. His attorneys figured it out. That's what Hesh owes in royalties. Of course, Paulie's all what? You know, Paulie does not want to be here. He doesn't think they should be talking to these rappers. You know, this is not normal at all, you know. And Christopher sticks up for Massive.
Way out of line, yeah.
Out of line. He sticks up for masters, goes against the family. Christopher is wrong here.
And, very reminiscent of Fredo in The Godfather.
Absolutely.
He brings up also, Massive Genius brings up Chuck D from Public Enemy, who at one time, I guess, suggested reparations from the Hollywood studios for the way that African-Americans were portrayed in the early, you know, movies in Hollywood. And Hesh is just like, you're out of your mind, buddy. It's not going to happen. I'm not.
He says, as Jews, they were persecuted before anybody. So, you know, that's his take on it. He ain't giving up 400 grand. There's not a chance. No. You know, not a chance. Cusumano House dinner. Melfi is there. She's with the old boyfriend, not the guy that the lieutenant beat up. She's with the guy originally.
From the pilot
where Tony gets them a table. They're making fun of the Sopranos. They're very snooty. Really arrogant, snooty. And she is very uncomfortable, Melfi, and obviously doesn't believe it. They're very condescending. I don't like this group of people personally.
Well, we do meet Cusumano's wife, Jean Cusumano, played by Sandra Santiago, who probably Miami Vice. She had a big part on that for a lot of that run. And she also was in Blue Bloods as well. She's done some work.
And she played two characters. She played, she played twin sisters. Is it
Jeannie Cusumano?
Jeannie and Joan.
Joan.
Huh. Joan, you see that in episodes coming up. Jeannie and Joan. And she's a terrific actress, right? And they're talking about Walken, and she says every time he's around Tony Soprano, he curses. And, you know, it's a real bullshit. I mean, it's a great scene. It's just something that annoyed the shit out of me.
And Melfi doesn't like it, and she sticks up for Tony. Yeah, absolutely. She sticks up for Tony Soprano here. You know, she doesn't like this.
Then here we are at the visiting day performs. Christopher, Adriana, are massive. They watch the band. The band is booed.
These guys who they cast, Nick Fowler and Greg Wattenberg, they were, you know, real musicians, very talented guys. They wrote those songs for the show. Greg Wattenberg is a successful producer and songwriter. He actually produced that song for Train, Hey Soul Sister, which was actually a big song back in early 2000 or late 90s. He's produced for Backstreet Boys and a lot of big bands. They were in the band called Tanto Tanto, and they wrote the songs, the Defiler song called Defiler, and the Visiting Day song, Ace Myself, which is what they're singing on stage here in the nightclubs. Kind of like a watered down REM or Radiohead, you know, alternative 90s music. Talented musicians, but just not good songs.
Terrible, and they're in the wrong place. They shouldn't be there. It's not the right crowd. The crowd starts booing. You could see Massive is eyeballing Adriana up and down. I don't know if at this point Christopher realizes that he's eyeballing Adriana. I'm not sure.
Oh, I think so. Yeah.
You think so? He's letting it go.
Well, it hasn't gotten out of line, but, you know, it's, you know, he has an agenda. He wants us to work for them somehow, but, you know, it is an issue, no doubt.
So back to the Cusumano dinner party. Melfi goes to the bathroom. Looks at the window. She wants to take a look at Tony Soprano's house. She hears grunting, you know, and she doesn't know where it's coming from. Startles her.
which comes back towards the end. It's an element in this episode, things not being how they appear to be. And we'll talk about that a little later. But why is she staring at Tony's house?
You know, I guess maybe she just wants to see how he lives.
She's intrigued.
I would say, listen, how does this guy live? This guy has these problems, but look at this massive mansion and grounds, and I think it's something on that order, personally. They're still, you know, they're real assholes at the dinner. I keep bringing that up because it annoys me. But Melfi goes to the bathroom. She can't, I mean, the sounds sound like someone's getting beaten, or I don't know what it is.
You know? Sex, it's, could be sex, you know, rough sex. I don't know. It's pretty disturbing, though. And
yes.
You know.
Christopher's bedroom. Chris and Adriana talk about the music.
One of the great lines of the show ever, that she says that this guy turned his life around. He had third-degree burns from trying to grill that trout with a down power line. That is, that image is just, I don't know. That must be a Renzulli line because it's just.
That is just hilarious. One of those things, once again, very subtle, extremely funny. And they talk about the music business and how well she's going to do. She is so excited. Christopher's given her this opportunity. She knows Christopher's excited, and they're going to do it. They're going into it. And Massive is making like he's very interested in the band.
Yeah, to the point where Christopher spends money and invests and actually, you know, buys recording time. We'll see that in a bit. But, yeah, they're going all in here.
Melfi's office, you know, he's telling he's talking about Cusumano, that he's a Wonder Bread wop, which is, I think, a Renzulli thing, which is a terrific, terrific line. And we all know Wonder Bread wops, and you know what that means. Like he says, eats sorts out of a jar, or eats gravy out of a jar.
Right, they've assimilated, yeah. They've lost a lot of that, you know, identity. I mean, she says you don't consider yourself white, which is an interesting... I don't really consider myself white. You know, whenever I have to fill out things, like I don't say white, I go to other and put Italian.
Oh, yeah?
I think there's a big distinction. I'm sorry.
That's interesting. I always say white. Well, there you go. Yeah. Well, I'm half a Jew, so... I guess
well,
I'm
that's
half
more
white.
Complicated.
I'm half
but
white.
There's a big difference, I think, you know, and I think a lot of people who are not Italian feel that way and look at Italians as other than, you know.
Yeah, well, especially in the older days, that's for sure. You know, years ago, you know, Cusumano and his group, but this is part of the 20 million people that Melfi's ex-husband were talking about.
Right. Which you I know? Think now it's actually 15 million.
15 million. Why, the more people joined the mob?
No, 15 million Italians in America.
Oh, okay.
Italian Americans. Yeah.
Here they are at the neighbor's barbecue. They're making small talk. Tony's trying to be one of the guys. Oh, but in Melfi's office, before I get away from that, she says, why don't you want to hang out with these kind of guys? And he says... You know, the guys, his group, will make fun of him, kind of peer pressure. If I hang out with that group, these guys are going to say, what are you doing with these Americans? Bah, 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 bah.
They might also think that Tony's being, you know, snobbish hanging out with them. Like,
I think like Carmella, Tony kind of wants to a little bit. He's got the big house, the block. I think in a way, Tony wants to be accepted by them. It's just a regular guy, you know.
It was interesting though when he's leaving Melfi's office and he says, "Oh, you saw my house," and he kind of teases her a bit. There's a little bit like he's almost flattered that she made saw his house or looked at her, made it. You know, there's something he feels like he's in her head a little bit.
Well, like he said, you know, this could maybe he's thinking like kind of. A little zinger that could be yours. That could have been yours. Or if you would have hung with me, you could live the way I live. You know, that kind of thing. So these guys are just complete assholes. They're talking stocks, insider trading, and the same thing with Carmella. She's talking to the wives, talking about they never lose when they invest in stocks. So these people are corrupt. They come off as they're holier than thou.
They're corrupt. Why? Because they do insider trading or whatever?
Of course. Of course. So what? Is white collar crime?
Are they talking about insider trading? I mean, they're talking about investing in. Are they really? Yeah.
Well, he's telling them Delplex. he's saying, and Tony questions it, and they all, their assholes pucker up a little there. Whoa, he's not supposed to hear that. And it's going to become an IPO. It's going to go on the stock market. They're going to get in before it does. They're going to make money.
That's illegal.
That's certainly illegal. Okay. It's, you know, it's crime. It's just white collar crime.
But they also like playing up like this almost quasi tough guy thing, you know, like, I guess, is it like Gordon Gekko from the movie Wall Street? This guy, this ruthless kind of guy who fucks people over, like that's admirable somehow in their world to be the cutthroat, fuck people over.
I mean, like I said, it's very contradictory. Here they are talking about Tony Soprano and they're. They're not solid citizens. They're full of shit, all of them. And that's what Carmela says. You play the stock market, and she says, well, we win. We never lose or whatever the line is.
Well, they bring up American Biotics. They say they're working on an anti-impotence drug because Viagra was just coming out on the market around the time this was shot. So it was not in the public consciousness so much. It wasn't like a household name like it has become. So it was probably right. It might not have been on the market when they shot this. It might have been later that year, but it did come on the market in 98. So that's what they're investing in.
So Hesh is at his house. He's reminiscing, listening to the doo-wop music. He looks at the old pictures. He's thinking
the song back. Fool that's playing, which is supposed to be by this little Jimmy Wills. The song is Fools Follow Angels, but it was two songwriters wrote it for the show, Tom Harriman and Pamela Phillips Olin, who were, you know, professional songwriters. That it's not a song from the 50s or whatever. He's drinking and he's reminiscing, but I kind of wish they would have had a scene with the wife of the guy or something, because it seems like Hesh is not really that conflicted here. I don't really.
You don't think so? You don't think he's feeling bad about it?
I think it needed more. I think if they would have had a scene with Hesh seeing the wife of this guy, or really driving home how much loss there was because of, you know, this musician getting ripped off. If you really saw more of the repercussions of what happened, you know, you don't really see it, and you don't.
But you know what might have got him? Massive says at one point, she said that nice man.
A little bit.
I don't know.
It's a great cut, though, going from that song, which is very good.
Great
to Visiting Day in the studio doing Erase Myself, which is not very good. You know, but like Hesh says later on, a lot of people are very talented. It's not enough to be very talented. These musicians are very talented, this Visiting Day band. They can play their instruments. He can sing very well. That's not enough. You know what I mean? I remember having an argument with a musician who thought Nirvana was bullshit because their music's really easy to play. And it's like, degree of difficulty has nothing to do with whether something is a great work of art or not. You know, it's not about that. It's about, you know, whether or not it touches you. And that, this band does not, obviously. They're having trouble in the studio here. It's not working out. The singer talks about it's his job at Kinko's, which is...
That's hilarious. Just, Kinko's, yeah. Is there any Kinko's left? There might be.
Yeah, they merged with FedEx.
This is a great scene. I mean, you know, Adriana's, she's doing her best, you know, she's really trying. And she's all gung-ho. She really thinks this band is great. She loves the band. Christopher gets pissed. He's paying $300 an hour. This Richie Santini mouths off to Chris, the wrong guy.
Chris thinks giving him drugs might help because in his brain, he thinks like, well, rock stars use drugs, right? All the famous rock stars use drugs. So maybe he needs drugs. And Chris's twisted mind, he's thinking drugs are going to help the situation.
Yeah, but Chris is saying, spike up, not even snort it. Spike up. I mean, get a needle. Shoot this up right now. I mean, that's...
I guess he's thinking musicians, that's what they do. Jim Morrison.
I found that in a sick way funny. Like, instead of saying, hey, wake up, this was like, spike up, get in there now. Breaks the guitar over
El Kabong. Remember El Kabong? The cartoon. It was Quick Draw McGraw's alter ego with the. It was like a horse with a guitar.
Yeah,
he would hit people over the head. It was a cartoon way back in the day.
There is a great video on YouTube. I don't know the comic's name, but he's being heckled, and they're heckling bad. And this guy goes, and you all you see is the comic. He's a guitar player. And the guy goes, yeah, well, come on up here. The comics, this one guy is heckling him. And boom, he hits the guy in the audience with the guitar. He busted over the guy's head, and the audience turns on him. It's amazing.
If you, wow, that's extreme.
Go on YouTube. Just put in comic hits audience member with guitar. So Carmella orders on the sly. Without Tony knowing, 5,000 shares of American Biotics. And Meadow walks in. She questions, oh, you play the stock market now. A woman has to keep her sense of individuality. She's trying to watch out for herself, for her own security. And, of course, she bribes Meadow. Even though it doesn't come off that way, how about a spa day?
But what also this scene does is it's setting up this comparison between these two mob wives, between Carmella and Adriana, both of whom are trying to aspire to have their own income, have their own career in some respect. And Carmella, in many ways, is exactly what Adriana doesn't want to be. She doesn't want to be in the kitchen. She doesn't want to be just, you know, a housewife. She wants to have, you know, her own career and her own identity. But it's interesting how you see these two characters, you know, set up in this episode, the Carmella and Adriana.
Well, you know, I don't know if we talked about it, but when they were in the burger place earlier after the play, she, you know, they're kind of mocking Tony and Carmella.
Yeah, she says that's not what she wants. She doesn't want to be, you know, just like some, you know, housewife raising kids, cooking, and, you know, being, she wants, you know, her own career. The country club. This is a really great scene. I thought the golfing scenes were really well done. And the guys, they're just being such assholes. And being very kind of direct and ballsy. Like, you know, you're with a wise guy and you're bringing up the Godfather. I mean, it's just like,
they're very
way out of line.
Way too comfortable. Way too comfortable.
Way too comfortable. Way out of line. Tony's calling Cusimano Coos as a nickname, which he's not too happy with.
They're talking about Al Capone in Florida. I mean, these guys are schmucks. They really are. And then Tony brings up the have you ever met John Gotti? And Tony brings up this complete bullshit story about Bungalow Bar.
Fascinating story. I mean, a really well-written, why that story, why he goes to Bungalow Bar. There's the ice cream thing in the other episodes. Johnny Soprano brings him ice cream when he gets out of jail. And Tony and AJ bond over a sundae after AJ gets suspended from school. So there's that ice cream thing. But it's just such a, you know, it just hits these very strange, because it's very sweet. There's an innocence to it. Yet he is talking about Gotti. It's very outlandish. You know, he says that Gotti outbid him for the last Bungalow Bar truck. Bungalow Bar was like Good Humor.
Yeah, did you
They
know?
Had it in the Bronx.
Are you too old? I'm too young.
In Mount Vernon, where I lived, we had Good Humor, we had Hood, and we had Mr. Softy. We had three ice cream trucks. Mr. Softy would come at 11 o'clock at night in the summer in my neighborhood. In the Bronx, where my grandmother lived, they had Bungalow Bar, which, because I used to spend, you know, summers there sometimes. So what I loved, he said, Gotti drove him home in the Bungalow Bar truck and rang the bell the whole time. And he makes this gesture like,
it's very funny.
Jerk offs or pulling the chain or whatever it is. It's like, it's so good. And Jim just does it so well. The story is so specific and so, you know, it's so kind of weird.
And it came off the top of his head so quick. Now, Bungalow Bar in my neighborhood in Brooklyn. So it was Good Humor and Bungalow Bar. And the guy would, and we all ate Good Humor ice cream. And for people out there that doesn't know what that is, it was just ice cream bars or cups with the wooden spoon. And he would ride a bicycle with a big refrigerator truck, and he would be all around the neighborhood all day long, coming around, ringing the bell, and the kids would all run to it. Now, Bungalow Bar, we used to terrorize this guy. The guy was kind of an asshole, and we would go, Bungalow Bar tastes like tar. The more you eat, the sicker you are. And we would fucking do it every time he came around, and he would get out of the truck and chase us sometimes because nobody bought Bungalow Bar. I just thought
he only bought good humor.
Only good humor.
Did you have Mr. Softy, the soft serve?
Oh, yeah.
Did he come around late at night, like at 11 o'clock?
I don't remember that. But I remember.
I told my kids that. They were like, what? Yeah. The ice cream man came around 11 o'clock at night. They're like, what? I said, yeah, in the summer, people still be hanging out.
Imagine now. They would have calls, complaints. I mean, they get arrested, the guy, you know.
They bring up the photo of the Carmine Galante hit, which I find very, that's a very... very disturbing photo. He's kind of crumpled on the floor with a cigar in his mouth.
He was in a restaurant in Bushwick. Yeah, Bushwick.
Knickerbocker Avenue. Yeah. I think it was called Joe and Mary's. But it's a very disturbing crime scene photograph. But they bring that up. I mean, it's very...
I mean, they are so out of line. How he kept his cool, I don't know. I mean, they are real fucking schmucks, these guys.
And Cusimano feels bad, I think. He's in an awkward place because he knows these guys are being assholes. And he's, you know, he likes Tony. And I think he feels bad that these guys are being such idiots.
They're kind of like mocking him. They're, I'm surprised he didn't just, you know, snap on them. But trying to keep his cool. They're at the country club. He wants to join the country club.
You know? He wants to join the country club. Do you think Tony ever met John Gotti? Tony Soprano?
I don't know. I'm not quite sure how big he, you know, I don't know. You know, for all that he was the head of a mob family, he still was doing a lot of dirty work throughout the series.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, maybe not.
You know what I mean? Like, he's still going on, you know, stick-ups and, you know, shakedowns. He was still doing that. Even the first season, we see it. So, I don't know. You know, I don't know.
Did you ever meet John Gotti?
No. No, I never did.
Did you ever see him?
No. In the 80s and during that time, 90s, I was living in Las Vegas. So, I wasn't around there. When I lived on Mulberry Street.
At a wedding. I used to work in a wedding hall in Eastchester, New York. And, once in a while, they'd have, mob weddings, which were usually the really big ones, 500 people, top shelf. They would go till 5 in the morning. They'd have breakfast at like 3 in the morning. And there was one, and he was a guest there. And we were all, everybody was very excited. I wasn't working that party, but I went down just to get a glimpse of
him. I'm sure he was a big tipper.
Yeah, everybody was very happy.
I would imagine he was.
Wise guys are usually good tippers.
Yes, oh yes, absolutely. As opposed to most actors, sports guys, which we talk about, you know, no Pippin tipping. Tiger Woods is the worst tipper in the history of the universe. Listen
best
to
golfer,
me.
Best golfer, worst tipper.
The worst tipper. Adriana, you know, plays the demo for Genius. She's meowing and dancing along.
That was a rough scene to shoot because... we were just hysterical. Her meowing, you know, I mean, because the song's so corny, and she was a very good sport, but it was just,
she's meowing.
We dying of laughter. It took a lot of takes to get that one right. It was just so silly. But she's
pitching the song. Chris is there. Genius is looking her up and down, you know, and he says he likes it. He likes the song, but as we know, he likes her more than he likes the song.
And I think he's waiting to see what Hesh is going to do.
The song is awful.
Keeping the lines of communication open because he wants the money from Hesh. You know what I mean? I don't think he has any plans of doing music with these guys. No, absolutely not.
Absolutely not. But then again, if it was good, maybe.
But as we see in the next scene... It's not good.
No.
According to Hesh, Christopher plays the demo for Hesh because Hesh is in the music business. I was in the music business, and Hesh says, I think it's not good. A hit is a hit, and this, my friend, is not a hit. For a reason, and why is it not a hit? For reasons we couldn't comprehend or codify. Which is what we were saying before. Just because they're talented and can play their instruments, you know, you have to have more than that. You have to have some magic. You have to have some charisma, something that sets you. It's not enough to be good, you know, or proficient in your instrument. You have to have something.
He mentioned Hendrix. He mentions Jimi Hendrix. He saw him. He knew that he had it down in the village, which is where Tony Sirico used to give him wedgies, as we talked about in an earlier episode.
Tony told me that he used to give Jimi Hendrix a wedgie.
You think he gave the atomic wedgie where they pull your underwear
over your head? No. I don't think that had been invented yet.
Oh, okay. Okay. No. So it wasn't that. They didn't have – a lot of guys wore boxers back then.
I don't know what kind of – he never mentioned what kind of underwear Jimmy wore.
I'm going to call Tony and find that out.
Find out, yeah.
All right? I will find that out. So he tells – you know, Hesh says too, now get the fuck – tells Christian, get the fuck out of here and stop wasting my time. He's still annoyed that he went against him at the sit-down.
He's annoyed. I'm surprised he even took – you know, listened to the demo, you know, and gives him the benefit of the doubt here. But Chris – after hearing, Chris is very upset, but Chris thinks he takes Hesh's word for what, you know, and thinks, all right, this we're back in the wrong horse.
But I think Chris gives a look in when she's singing Meow, Chris knows already. He's just going to get a verified. Christopher knows the song stinks. He knows it. Melfi's office. He tells the story about Jimmy Smash, a kid in the neighborhood. He had a cleft palate. They used to have him sing. They made fun of him. They mocked him. And then he found out years ago, Jimmy Smash would come home and cry at night. And Tony kind of felt that way, like a dancing bear. He was there for their amusement, like Jimmy Smash. And he does the voice. And Melfi doesn't give anything. It's very funny. And Melfi, nothing, you know.
So Tony feels, you know, for the first time what it's like to be, you know, to be the object of other people's amusement, to be, you know, used for other people's, you know, kicks, and he doesn't like it.
The massive, they're at the pool, Hesh calls him. And they're talking on the phone on a conference call. Tony says, I bet you have a college degree. And Massive says, I guess after he killed someone, he went back and got his degree. I think that's what he said.
He says he grew up, you know, in the projects and killed someone, which I'm not sure is true. He seems like, you know, that might just be bullshit, that he's really was a middle class kid who went to college and is now, you know, doing this, you know, is in a rap business. But, you know, this is a. There's this theme of things not being what they appear to be, you know, like with Massive Genius, they think, you know, maybe this is going to be some big gang war. And it turns out he's just going to sue him with.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, the lawyers at the end with the package, you know, he thinks it's something very sinister and it's just sand. The grunting sounds like it could be somebody getting killed, but it's just a guy working out. There's that, you know, several different
There's no
images
violence
of this.
Besides the killing at the beginning, there's no violence in this one.
No, wrong. Yeah, Paulie, right at the beginning there.
Paulie kills him, and then after that, that's it.
And this doesn't compute to Paulie Walnuts. These guys wanting to sue each other. He thought they were going to go to the mattresses with these dudes.
He's wearing a bulletproof vest.
He's ready. Yeah, he's ready. And he does not understand them using lawyers. That to him does not compute.
And Silvio says it's a new day. Hesh is going to countersue because they sampled one of his records by the Chablis.
The Chablis.
Christopher's apartment. Adrian is trying on the clothes. Christopher says, you know, you could have both outfits, and it comes out with a visiting day sucks. Silvio knows it. she's saying, you're just trying to hold me down. You don't think I could do this. Christopher says, I love you. She walks out.
He feels
out.
Really bad. He's breaking her heart, and he knows that he doesn't want it. He wanted this to work out for her, but it's not. He has to be realistic here, and she's not being. She doesn't. You know, it would have been a disaster if they would have pursued this. I like that he brings up Silvio used to own clubs in Asbury Park. That's a reference to little Steven Van Zandt, who that's where he started. I think him and Bruce were had an apartment in Asbury Park back in the day when they were performing at the clubs there, Stone Pony and all that. You know.
And then he says he knows about this stuff. Then we go to Soprano Kitchen. Carmela, you see the stock is split. 3-1 She hides the newspaper. Right. The stock makes some money. She's got 5,000 shares.
And she doesn't tell, like Tony didn't tell her that he made a score. She's not going to tell him that she made a score.
She's going to have a little stash on the side. Then Tony's wrapping up a box of sand. Carmela's all for it. That's so evil, but he's going to, you know, do what he's got to do with Crisimano. And she says, you're cute when you.